Now, I'm going to kick things off with a question for everyone, a classic first base one, but let's just do it. I'd love to know how you guys all individually got involved with the project and what appealed to you, the roles in particular, because they're all quite different, I'd say. Maybe kick things off with Karen, do you mind?
Well, I just got a call from my agent and they were like, are you willing to shave your head for a role in a Marvel film? And I said, absolutely. And then I just auditioned. And then a few auditions. This is a boring story. And then I met James in the studio, Shepperton, where we shot the film. And it was really exciting. And then I did a screen test and got the role. It was really appealing.
I told her the other day in person, Karen's audition is my favorite, or her screen test is my favorite, sorry guys, but her screen test is my favorite audition of anybody in the entire process was, you know, her audition was my favorite. It's the coolest.
Thanks, man.
I gotta ask why.
Because she was so good. It was like she took this character that was a pretty simple character and it was, it was a pretty long sequence and it was just very, it was actually very moving, this character that she created out of this bald cyber jerk. So I like it. Yeah. Yeah, and I think that it's in, you know, her character is sort of, we think of her, she's almost like the Boba Fett of the movie. And she has some, just these little moments in the movie where you can see that there's a lot more to this character than just being a villainess.
Boba Fett, big shoes to fill, for sure.
Oh, God.
Chris, can you beat Karen's story? How was your screen test? Did you know from the off that you were ready for this?
I figured if I could just get them to believe me physically as a character, that I would be mine. I really felt like James and I gelled in a nice way and seemed to have almost immediately I felt like I was right, like my spirit was right for this character, and the way I sounded was the way he'd sound. I just didn't look the part, and I wasn't walking around in like the right vehicle yet. And so I knew if I could convince them that they could take a chance on me and give it enough time, I'd be able to make create the, you know, change that was required to look like the character. I knew I would get the part, and so, and I also had an inside in because my friend Ben, who was essentially reading the role of Drax for all of the other screen tests, is like one of my very best friends.
And he's also one of my best friends.
Yeah, and we were really, and he was like, he's like, dude, you can't, Pratt, you can't tell anyone, but it's totally yours. Like, no one has come in and did what you did. You're going to get it. I was like, oh, that's good.
I told Ben, I was like, I am just now trying to check the boxes to get Pratt into the role so that he can be hired by Marvel and they can agree to hire him. With Dave, it was the same thing. I knew, you know, the interesting thing of me with all four of these actors here is, you know, I think back along the journey and with each one of them, like the minute we met, there was something very like just sincere between each of us. The first time I met, you know, Dave in that audition room, I just really got Dave. Chris and I had common friends and we met each other. You know, Karen, I remember, you know, hanging out in my office and just laughing our asses off and that first day we met. And then Zoe on the phone, who's going 1,000 miles a minute when I was on the phone with you, and just totally just got along really well. So it's one of those cool things where you still love everybody at the end of the project that you know, liked so much at the beginning. And that's probably the coolest thing about this movie for me.
It sounds like you had a great rap party with that kind of chemistry between you guys.
We were all kind of gone from the rap party.
I missed the rap party. Yeah. I always miss rap parties. Like, I always have to leave the day of the rap party. And then I hear the stories. But it's a good thing that I don't go to the rap party because I tend to rap the party, too.
Yeah, Dave and me, because you protected my brother from a guy that was trying to beat him up. Dave,
I can't believe I missed it.
There's a guy who was like a crew member who was bothering a bunch of people, and he came up and he was like offering me drugs, and I don't even drink, and I was like, what are you, you know, get away from me. And then he was, you know, he like, you know, grabbed the little person who played, who was like the reference for Rocket on set, he grabbed her, RT, and then there was another girl, Abby, who was one of the stand-ins, and he grabbed her butt. And my brother Sean, who plays Kraglin in the movie and who was on the on-set Rocket, who was not a big guy, got in this guy's face, and he was a big guy. And he's like, what are you doing? And somebody ran over to me and said, your brother's about to get into a fight. And I walked over to the guy, and I'm like, you got to get out of here. Leave, because he grabbed, this girl. And then Artie, who was the stand-in, came up and said, James, he picked me up by the tits. And I said, whoa. And Dave was there, and Dave said, what's the problem? And then this big guy came marching over to Dave, and he's like about to get in Dave's face, and Dave has actual superpowers, so it's pretty cool. And Dave just went like this with his hand, and he went,
look at
boom.
His hand, guys.
Yeah. And he
it's
went,
not just, it's like a hand.
He tapped the guy like this, and then the guy flew back like 30 feet. It was awesome. It was actual superpowers that Dave has. And I was pretty excited.
When you times. When you ask someone how the rap party was, that is not the answer you expect.
You all play incredible roles, but in your opinion, who do you think stole the show the most in the movie?
Fight.
In your opinion, who what?
Stole the show in the movie. In your opinion, who stole the show when you watched the film?
For me, I would have to say, Groot.
Me too.
He stole the show when we started working. I just had a soft spot for that big tree. He unconditionally loved us all. And even though, I'm mature and I'm pretty sane and I'm an actor. and you go, okay, this is make-believe. I know it's a fictional character. He moved me in such a way that I was like, screw that. Like, I want to believe that he's real, because what he's making me feel is very real. So it's Groot.
We have one for Groot.
Yeah, when the movie really takes off is when we zoom in on the Xandar Mall and we meet Rocket and Groot together, and you see Groot drinking out of the fountain, and you see Rocket with, looking through his vid screen for potential bounties. And that to me is the moment that there's this synergy that happens. Like, you take all of the parts, the Peter Quill, you've met Gamora, I don't think at that point we've met Drax yet, but you see somehow the sum is greater than the whole, and it's when Rocket is talking and he sees the little kid and he's like, who's this little guy? Look at this little, it's not cool to need help, and it's it becomes really fun, and you see that this world, this journey is going to be really good. So I'd say Rocket. I think Rocket probably in that moment steals the show for me.
I suppose, James, for you, it's like picking your favorite kid, isn't it?
Well, I have my favorite kid. It's Rocket, but I don't know if he necessarily steals the show. It's for me, in some ways, I think Groot. I just go by the tweets I get, and it's frankly, I get more tweets about Groot and Bautista than anybody else. I also like to say it's Bautista that steals the show because it embarrasses him, and so he's the one person I like to compliment as much as possible because he hates it. But really, I think everybody steals it. Chris obviously has emerged as a giant movie star from this movie, which is incredible. And Zoe is kind of the Clint Eastwood, and
I'm
she's
already
so
a
cool,
movie star.
Yeah, you are already a movie star. And Karen is just so visually arresting. I think of her as just this, she has this gigantic beauty and charisma that's just so present. Rocket's, maybe the funniest, and Groot is the soul of the movie. And then, Bautista comes in and he's just the most unique character in the whole movie. And he's so funny, and there's nobody else in the world that could play that role. And actually one of the comments I got the most on Twitter and Facebook from people who've seen the movie is that everybody kind of steals the movie in turn. And it really is an ensemble piece. And I think that's what makes it so good. There isn't that one character who everybody says, oh, it's this one guy. It's really the dynamism between the characters together that works more so than any individual character.
Or it's the prosthetic leg.
Which means the director.
Yeah.
Sure.
Zoe, Kermit the Frog once famously sang that it's not easy being green. How did you find it?
let me tell you something. When you think of things that are sexy, they're usually in pink or black or white or red. They're not in green. We don't even like vegetables. Half of us don't even eat vegetables, and they're green. So we started out with a really tough, in a very tough position, and I've never approached a character on a superficial level in terms of like, yeah, make her tits bigger and make the jeans tighter around the butt. And this time, you should have been in the wardrobe room when I was having a fitting. I was like, no, Alex, you just pad them up more. Like, you just make them like there, like out here. And the ass, get that wedgie just perfect. I was really concerned because I thought, if my character has to bring all the fanboys and find it appealing, we like things that are aesthetically beautiful, especially if it comes in a form of a woman. And, you know, green are Martians, swamp things are green, boogers are green. It's like, you know. I was adamant about finding that right shade.
And Dave, I've got to ask you, you know, being grey, what's it like? The tribal tattoos fascinate me. How hard is it to get that on every morning?
I'm still stuck on
boogers
time.
Are green.
Sorry. I made long list.
Yeah, no, it was okay. It was it wasn't nearly as bad as people think for some reason, because I'd really become close with my makeup team. Mm. And so the comparison I like to make is if you could, you know, imagine yourself just hanging out with five of your friends for 4 hours and having, you know, some good conversation, a lot of laughs, and listening to good music, it kind of flies by.
Yeah.
You know, but if true. It was more the consecutive days rather than the hours in the chair. It was like when it got to be like 3, 4, 5, 6 days in a row, then your skin just got real sensitive and kind of raw. And you just want that day off to feel clean, you know, take a shower and stop digging gunk out of your ears and blowing stuff out of your nose. Yeah. Did you blow green out of your nose?
Well, for like a month. After we wrap.
But yeah, no, it wasn't as bad as you would think.
That's good. You just, mostly because you have a good attitude, though. It's like,
it didn't, yeah, no, I'm going. Pretty patient. Zen.
Yeah, because he's really, he was for like, he'd have to have his arms outstretched like this for long periods of time. And it's, to me, it would be absolute hell because I have to be moving all the time. It would be very difficult. But I think with the green, the interesting thing for me is like, if I had to go back, I would really consider, you know, even though she's green in the comic books, changing her color, because it was so hard. It took us so long to find a green that
like
worked,
you
guys
tests.
Wouldn't believe. Because we found, you know, right away, you know, we have other characters who are blue. You know, Yondu and Ronan are both blue, and Nebula's blue. We have other characters who are, you know,
yellow.
Smaller characters who are yellow. We have other characters who are pink. And we found all of those colors were sort of, you know, natural to human beings in a strange sort of way. You could find a color that looked like skin, and green was really hard, and it just took a long time. It really was a struggle.
Yeah, like I remember some being in the makeup room and seeing some of the tests, and it was like a lighter shade of green, and then she just looked like she was seasick.
Yeah.
And it was like a darker shade of green. It was like, that looks like someone got painted green.
Yeah, that's, exactly. That's what
good
it was,
at all.
They look painted.
It was like
green,
you know.
is not a natural color that looks good on the skin, so it was really, you know, hard. It's a, you know, and it's a testament to Zoe's facial features too that it ends up looking as good as it does.
I'm guessing, Karen, you had the longest in the makeup.
Did I?
Did
yeah.
You?
5 hours.
Yeah. You and Dave,
I didn't have to stand up and put my arms out, though. I just watched Pulp Fiction on repeat. It was really fun.
Wow.
If the Guardians were to one day meet the Avengers, who would you like to work with or perhaps collide with?
I would like to see them kill Thor. I don't know. No, this is true. Chris and I were driving the other day. Where were we going?
Thor is like the only one that came to the premiere. Too.
Yeah,
he's
Thor
like
was in the premiere.
The most supportive
I'm
Avenger.
I'm kidding about Thor. I don't really want him to kill
Let's
Thor.
Kill Thor.
He's awesome. But Chris and I were driving somewhere the other day, and we were in the car, and we were in one of our ridiculous conversations, and we're talking about all the different things that could happen to the Guardians in this universe, as we do endlessly. You know, you think we're sick of hearing about the Guardians? No, we talk about it constantly. And he was saying, dude, seriously, I really, really think that Star-Lord should kill Iron Man. Like, the audience would be, it would be so awesome if he came down and he shot Tony Stark in the face. People would be so surprised. And I'm like, yeah, they would.
Well, I think it, you know, I think that would be awesome.
I know you do, I know.
Or like, or if not me, maybe Rocket. Like, Rocket, I don't know. So I think
does that something would, to his heart or like that shiny thing.
Because, you know, the without giving away any, you know, look, none of my ideas will ever make the movie, so I should just tell you all of them because it will never be a spoiler. But I know that like in the comic, like Gamora and Iron Man, you know, they have, and through the comics, they've hooked up. And how does Peter Quill feel about that? Maybe he doesn't like it, and then maybe Rocket hears it, that I don't like it, and then Rocket shoots Tony Stark, minute five, just blows a hole in his face? That would be amazing! People would be super mad, but it would be kind of great. You would be like, what? How did you do that? And they're like, because Robert Downey Jr. makes $100 million a movie. We can't afford to have him anymore.
Pratt's minimum wage. Let's keep him around.
Yeah, we can afford Pratt. He kills everyone.
I would pay good money to read the fan fiction you write.
Yeah, right?
I think that answers your question.
What songs do you guys want in the Awesome Mixtape Volume 2?
Well, I haven't figured out quite Awesome Mix Volume 2 yet, so they're really, you know, the truth is the songs that were chosen for the movie were chosen to be specific to those scenes, so it isn't so much about what, you know, what songs I like the best as it is about what songs speak to that scene, and all those songs were written into the script except for one, and so they were, you know, all part, they're sort of baked into the story of the Guardians of the Galaxy, which is what makes it work so well. So for me to think of a song that I like a lot that I want to put in the movie, it doesn't necessarily mean it works. I mean, one of my favorite scenes in the movie was to ELO's Livin' Thing, which we cut from the film, and that was, to me, Livin' Thing was like the main Guardian song because it was so, ELO seemed like the Guardian's house band almost. And now there's no ELO song in there, but it still, it works really well because the movie works better without that scene.
We need some ABBA in it. We need some Hall & Oates and some Air Supply.
I'd used Air Supply in Slither, so I paid my Air Supply debt.
That was fabulous.
I wouldn't mind seeing Peter Quill try to seduce somebody to like Lionel Richie. Yeah, like put it on like he's a Mac.
Like a comic.
Hello. Is it me you're looking for? And they're just like super serious and play a real, like that's how he's been getting with all these Pumelians, is just like this one Lionel Richie track.
Some purple girl.
Some purple girl, and she's just like crying because it's so beautiful. It's the most beautiful thing she's ever heard. Just super easy to hook up with Pumelians if all you need is Lionel Richie.
See, this is what we do, guys.
Pumelians. It is really a fact that Pumelians love Lionel Richie.
Yeah, everyone knows that. Yeah.
What song will we be playing when you kill Iron Man? I mean, probably not Lionel Richie.
Hello. Is it me you're looking? Credits roll. 7 minutes into the movie, it's over. Only worth it.
And then the rest of the movie is like a Weekend at Bernie's type thing with Robert Downey Jr.'s body to make him the most out of his contract.
It's skittering across the desert with the Iron Man thrusters on.
Yeah. He's flopping around his dead body in the Iron Man costume.
Yeah, totally.
Somebody get up and ask a question. We're gonna keep going all the way through lunch.
Chris, your character Che in the OC had an otter as his spirit animal. I was just wondering what each Guardian's spirit animal would be.
Wow.
What is
she's
your spirit
talking
animal?
About some of, she's talking about this like really profound season of the OC where my character my character Che Winchester had a spirit animal, which was an otter, and it's really deep. It's like really kind of a subversive. I mean, actually, if you have like 45 minutes, I could kind of walk you through the episode. But that's a really good question. What's your spirit animal? What's your character's spirit animal? Would be the question. I don't know. Do you guys have an answer?
I'd like to point out I asked for a serious question. But
you know, I guess for me, my spirit, Peter Quill's spirit animal, would probably be like a golden retriever. Yeah.
I see that. Yeah. I see that.
Okay. Yeah. He's a puppy. He's like a puppy in a way, you know. He's still kind of that 9-year-old boy that got taken away, but he's like, screw it, I'm gonna chase my tail and chase frisbees, you know. Anyone else?
I think usually I always find an animal for all the characters that I play. I just feel like people, we do also have animal personalities, and that's a good way of getting to know somebody on a primal level. But this time, Gamora wasn't an animal. You may think it's a reptile, but it wasn't. She was more of a bullfighter for me. Because obviously a woman cannot outfight a man with her strength, but she can outwit him. So I thought bullfighter is definitely seducible into surrendering into the sword, which obviously is not something that I appreciate deeply. But the psychological journey of that moment is something worth just observing and noticing. So I just thought, well, if she's a woman, she's not going to be stronger than a lot of her opponents, but she's definitely going to be wittier.
How about you, Dave? What's your spirit animal?
My spirit animal?
Yeah.
For Drax?
Yeah, is it a bull?
No, it'd probably be something like a big dumb dog, like Great Dane or something like that.
Bulldog.
Yeah.
We're going to go for another dog here. Karen, what are you going to pick?
I mean, what animal takes itself way too seriously? Maybe like a sloth? No, that's... Those are passive. Maybe, I don't know, what's a really serious animal? Like a tiger?
I think you're like a shark.
Shark. That one.
A cybernetic shark.
Yep.
Yes, Oreo Raccoon is the rescue raccoon. He was rescued when he was only, I think, 4 days old and hand-fed, and he's the raccoon who came with me as my date to the premiere last night, and he was the reference raccoon for Rocket, and he's a real sweet little guy, and I actually, after the premiere, I went over there and he tackled me and didn't rip my suit, but that's all right.
That's good to know, because my fiancé will be obviously wearing a suit on the wedding day.
So. Yeah, be careful. He's very nice. He'll never try to hurt you.
Yeah, I have met him.
But he likes to wrestle.
Yeah.
Chris, those are some impressively smooth dance moves you do. Devastating dance moves. Did you come up with the choreography yourself?
Yes, I did. That was sort of a, you know, kind of a throwback. I think like everything about Peter Quill, it had to be 1988 or earlier. And so I thought of a lot of Michael Jackson, some moves from the disco era, a little bit of early hip hop and stuff like that. So I remember around that time in my life, my brother and I would have dance-offs in our basement. And so there was sort of that spirit in it a little bit. But yeah, those are my moves, and oddly never got paid as a choreographer. At least not yet, so.
The whole appeal of this project in the first place was to create not just a world, but many worlds. And I think I would have a very hard time doing like a sequel to another Marvel movie or even setting up another character to be in the Avengers. But I felt a lot of freedom in creating this movie. And I'm very, very grateful to Marvel, because every time I came up with some crazy idea, I'm like, you know, let's just have a 7-page scene where the characters argue about stupid stuff at the beginning of the third act, and Marvel's like, oh, that's great, we love it, or, you know, let's, you know, just have all these bright colors like old 50s and 60s movies, and they're like, we love it, and I'm like, let's add Michael Rooker, who's totally insane, and put him in the role of Yondu, and they're like, we love it. And it's just like, they really, for some reason, you know, I was allowed to go hog wild, and it's been an amazing experience, and I know for all of us, unless that they're, you know, being dishonest with me, which I don't believe they are, this has felt like a special movie to all of us from the very beginning, and it just was sort of the flavor of it. The flavor of it was special, and we felt like we were doing something that was both very new, very unique, and then also harkened back to the films that we all loved as a kid. I mean, one of my favorite moments is showing Zoe some scenes during the dubbing scene. She's like jumping around like a little kid, because it was like, I remember how I felt when I saw Raiders of the Lost Ark when I was a little kid, or Empire Strikes Back. And
or Spaceballs.
So it was fun to,
Spaceballs.
To create, you know, to create that sort of thing, and try to make something that's, you know, so many movies today are so dark and brooding, to be able to create something that's a little bit, you know, more fun, but yet also has the emotional weight and the you know, the heart to it as well. There's a few deleted scenes that we have that aren't in the movie, and there are also outtakes of things that, because we would goof around a lot on set doing things, and sometimes those are used in the trailer as well.
There are a couple of scenes that we shot, Gamora and Nebula, where you sort of explain that dysfunctional relationship that Ronan and Nebula and Gamora had by being abducted and forced into a life of crime and violence by Thanos and his group of thugs. And I would love to see that in the DVD.
Me too. The marketing's amazing. Like, the truth is, I'll be completely honest with you, like, we went out and we tested those original trailers that we did for the movie. We had, like, a really, like, mainstream one that made it look all serious, and that these guys were, like, you know, made it look like a very just normal, like, science fiction space movie. And then we had the trailer that we did with Hooked on a Feeling and all of that stuff, and we took them out to malls and showed people, and people were kind of like, I don't like any of these, you know? And so we're like, well, if they hate them all, then we might as well go with the one that is most honest and true to the film, which was the Hooked on a Feeling one, which really gave you a flavor of what the movie was. And it just shows you that stuff is all bullshit, because people then love the trailer. We beat every other movie, and, you know, we had, you know, in our time slot, we had 3 times the amount of hits that Man of Steel had on the first day, and nobody knows who the Guardians of the Galaxy are. So it worked really well, and it was just because it was true to the movie, and that's been our philosophy every step of the way. And this is really a testament to, you know, I've given tribute to Marvel, but it's Disney, the Disney marketing team, who decided to have the balls to just kind of sell this movie as what it is and not try to make it into something else that's more palatable to what they think of as middle America. And that has been a pretty cool experience. And marketing, you know, detest would have said, don't do that. And they did it. And somehow, we'll find out if it worked in a couple days, but it seems to have worked pretty well.